We are proud to partner the San Antonio Hispanic Chamber of Commerce with the San Antonio Chamber of Commerce. Both of our organizations are very fortunate to have each other as partners and to complement our missions in pursuit of education this morning, along with the San Antonio Independent School District Foundation. I wanted to welcome you officially to our partnership. We have over 300 people with us this morning. Give yourself a round of applause. Thank you for your enthusiasm. You all know how important education is. It's the most valuable currency in the world. And in San Antonio, a city that is growing by 20% every 10 years and has consistently done that since 1980, a city of 1.4 million, sustaining that growth, but also uplifting and building a workforce is critically important. Education is the most important commodity in local economic development. So the work of the San Antonio School District, its trustees, Pedro, and each of you that form part of that fabric is critical to both the San Antonio Chamber and the San Antonio Hispanic Chamber of Commerce, and of course, the larger business community. I get to introduce Ms. Patty Radel. When I was the city's director of economic development, we did a lot of cool things. We started the foundations, the academies, we brought Toyota to town, we did the settlement agreement with the Alamo colleges to put more money into workforce development. And we needed champions on the council. Many of you were there during those times. We funded the first $1 million tranche for the local match for the School of Biology, Science, and Engineering at UTSA when Deborah Guerrero was councilwoman. And then we created the Center for Infrastructure Assurance and Security at UTSA, which is now the best cyber college in America. So this city's done great things, and it has many more great things too. But one of those champions at the time that I had the honor to work with as a councilwoman was Ms. Patty Radel. We also created the West Side Development Corporation to focus economic development on the West Side. And before I introduce her, I loved working with her because she was all heart, but she was gonna tell you what she felt. And so I was at a meeting once thinking I was Mr. Big Cheese, and I was talking about economic development and incentives. And I said, yes, Councilwoman, we can do that. We can kill two birds with one stone when we do this. And she looked at me, she stopped me in front of everybody. She goes, Ramiro, yes, Councilwoman. She goes, I'm a pacifist, so you can't use that phrase, kill two birds with one stone. So I've learned that lesson. I don't use that term anymore, Patty, but I love Patty Radel. She is our president of the SAISD Board of Trustees, elected May of 2011. She's a graduate of Marquette University with a major in theology. She obtained her teacher in bilingual certification and second major in English from Our Lady of the Lake University. She was recently awarded an honorary doctorate in theology from the Oblate School of Theology. She taught elementary school in SAISD for 12 years in high school and middle school in local school systems. She has served on the San Antonio City Council from 2003 to 2007. Ms. Radel has also served with her husband, Rod, as the volunteer director for inner city development since 1972. Her current term expires in 2019. Let's all thank Ms. Radel for the wonderful work she does. Let's give her a round of applause. Join me.
I love working with Ramiro. Don't you love working with Ramiro? Give Ramiro a And I certainly want to thank the Hispanic Chamber and thank the San Antonio Chamber and thank our wonderful San Antonio Independent School District Foundation for putting this together for us and giving us a platform to talk about the wonderful things that are happening. So thank you so very, very much. But I also want to offer a much broader thank you. We've been through a lot in the last year and a half, and the successes and the opportunity for the initiatives we anticipate have come with wonderful support of the people in this room. The bond and the TRE, I mean, how many cities have such wonderful support? How many citizens vote at 70% to increase their taxes in two different ways on one ballot? truly been a community effort. I think all of us felt the wonderful support from the community. It was amazing to have such support from the business community and our families, our parents, our other community members. It just really felt like we are moving forward as a true community, a family community. And this morning, I wanted to just very briefly address an issue that, you know, has been on the news, and to say how fortunate it is that we have this breakfast this morning after one of our colleagues resigned last night. Many of you have seen the issue on the news. And I just want to say that, you know, obviously to our board, it brings a sadness. It is a time for us to do some grieving, but it is not going to be our distraction in moving forward. And we want to move forward with you. We want you to continue to have the faith in us, because while this is one person's dilemma, and we are not the judge and jury, and that has to move through the process, our focus, as it has been, is on 53,000 children. And so we had a journey together. It's a long road. It's a long time in the car together. You know, there'll be challenges along the way. I can hear the voices of people who have made long road trips with their children. And you know the things that can happen, but we're together, and we appreciate that. And just to make a brief statement together, I'd like to ask our board members to stand. Again, former Mayor Garza, Mr. Howard, Ms. Guerrero, Mr. Valdez, Mr. Leschno, if you would remain standing, please. Because we want to say to you together that we have a tremendous leader in whom we have much faith in. And we want you to know that we are behind him. We are not a group of yes men or women, because we dig deep in these issues and we have tough discussions. But in the end, we come out with wonderful support for these initiatives that we're going to take on. And we want to assure you that we are together, and we will continue to look deep, and we will travel together. And we give you a warning. Our leader, Pedro Martinez, drives at about 90 miles an hour. And the only signs he looks at along the road are those that say, this way to success. So I hope you stick with us, have faith in us. We are all in this together. And we're gonna have a very brief video, and then I ask you to give a warm welcome. It's like 1 minute. And welcome Pedro Martinez to our stage. Thank you again to all the support you have rendered to this district. It's fantastic. Thank you.
The only thing that's harder than being, you know, superintendent is being a parent. For my wife and I, it's very personal because it was our education that helped us come out of poverty. We decided that our children were going to go to public schools here in San Antonio ISD. And for me, when I look at my son, when I think about the quality of education that I want him to have, I think about all of our 53,000 children. I want our teachers to love our children. I want our principals to love our children. But let's love them to a better life. Let's love them to Harvard. Let's love them to Yale, to Stanford. Because if we want to help our children, the best way to help them out of poverty is give them a great education. If they're successful, if they have great careers, we'll see stronger communities. We'll see stronger economic development. And that's what our role is in our communities.
My biggest fear is that I would come here and I'd see an empty room. And that's always something that I'm always afraid of. But I'll tell you, you know, Ms. Rado said this very well. One of the things that makes this job not only motivating, but also doable is the fact that we're not alone. And so thank you. Thank you for being with us. So today, you know, there's a couple of takeaways that I want you to have from today. So one is I want you to have some context to what we're doing, because I think it's always so important to not only understand the work we're doing, but what the context of it is here in our state and in the country. And then the other is I want you to see, and President Rado said this, I mean, we are going to show proof points. We are going to show that even though it will take time to transform the district, you're going to see evidence that we're making changes, movements in the right direction. And I'll tell you, you'll see why I am so optimistic about where we're going as a district. So let's start with this. So take a look at this. This is a study from Georgetown, and they do this by state, and it's one of the most in-depth studies in the country that looks at what children will need for tomorrow's jobs. So look what it says. More than 65% of students for tomorrow's jobs will require some post-secondary education. This is nationwide. By the way, Texas is very reflective of the nation. In fact, we have one of the most diverse economies in the country, but we're very much in line with this. By the way, it is not a coincidence that our governor and our state has put a goal that by 2030, 60% of all children need to have some post-secondary certificate. By the way, it doesn't mean a university degree, but it does mean that they need more than high school. This is a question I get every day. Pedro, do you say that everybody has to go to college? Keep in mind, there's different colleges. There's universities and there's colleges, and tomorrow's jobs require more than a high school diploma. So look at this slide. So this slide was actually, came from the commissioner, who I have a lot of respect for. So Commissioner Morath presented this first in front of many superintendents across the state. And you know, look at this slide and look what it shows you. So what you see in the first columns are the percentage of our children that are scoring, and we call it at the final level of proficiency. So our state has been phasing in much more difficult assessments that are actually much more accurate and much more telling about the capabilities of our children statewide. So look at where we're at right now in third and fifth and eighth grade. And this is statewide, ladies and gentlemen. So that's where we're at. Look at, as we get into SAT and ACT, which the SAT and ACT, if a child scores college ready, that means they have a 75% chance of being successful in their freshman year of college. So look at the percentage that we have right now, statewide, of the percentage of children that are college ready on the ACT and SAT. Look at graduation rates. So do you see a little bit of a disconnect there? So I'll tell you, you know, it's fascinating, and this is why I have so much respect for the commissioner. He's having this conversation, and I would say probably in the first time for several decades, right? This disconnect that exists between these graduation rates that we have, that we celebrate, that we should be celebrating that, but look at the other metrics. Keep going and go all the way down to the last metric. Look at the percentage of children that are actually finishing successfully in our state. And this is not a four-year degree, by the way. This is either a two-year or four-year degree, right? So context. Look at this slide. And I gotta tell you, it was interesting when I saw this slide and he showed this to us. So the top line shows the percentage of children. So this is now breaking that 17% by economic advantage. So in other words, the top line is our middle-class families. The bottom line is our high poverty families. Now look what you see there. Statewide, by the way. So by the way, for the small print, it goes back 20 years. So for 20 years in our state, our high poverty children, less than 5%, especially in those beginning years, were college ready on the ACT and SAT. Look at all the way, and now and we're a little higher, right? We're at 7%, ladies and gentlemen. 7% of our children right now over a 20-year period from about, you know, just under 5%. Now, if you go to the higher line, you see more of our middle-class families, and I get this debate a lot. People say, well, you know, Superintendent, are you saying that everybody should go to college? Because you know that that's not necessarily the case. Well, okay, so let's talk about that. So look at that line. So, you know, we're right now just above 25% of our, these are middle-class families that are college-ready. So you can argue that not everybody should go to college, but my question to you would be, does that mean that 75% of our middle-class families shouldn't be college-ready? Question, right? So that's the context of the work. So as you look at our district, and you look at that bottom line, and I'll show you some more stats, by the way, our state is getting poorer. Look at the percentage of children that are economically disadvantaged statewide. It's grown out at 60%. So again, put that in context with that other line, with that other graph. Here's some other data. So we went back and said, okay, let's really talk about poverty. So we compared ourselves with Northside and Northeast. And by the way, you know what was fascinating when we did this work? The high percentage of children that are qualifying for free lunch at Northside and Northeast. That means their population is getting poor. Not free and reduced, by the way. This is free lunch, which means that these families, on average, have a family size of four or more, and they make less than $30,000 a year. That's what that means. But look at our percentage. We're more than double even Northside and Northeast. But I was actually surprised how high the percentage of free, well, families apply for free in Northside and Northeast. So context, right? So this is what's happening in our state right now as our demographics are changing. Here's another stat for you. So look at the median income for Texas. Look at what it is for Bexar County. By the way, Bexar County and Texas very much resemble each other. It's interesting. Demographics, whether it's income, even academic achievement, very much mirror each other. Look at our district, $31,000. Compare that to Northside and Northeast. But keep in mind, even in Northside and Northeast, the percentage of children qualifying for free lunch is growing because overall our poverty is growing in the state. So that's the context of the work. So, you know, for us, as Ms. Rado said, you know, it is so important to have support from the community because this is a big challenge. And I'm going to go back to this line. To change this, this is the challenge of the nation. This is the challenge that everybody's trying to figure out. There is no magic bullets. I will tell you right now, I've been doing this for more than 20 years. There is no magic bullets. Every time I see something like this, I get angry because I was that kid who grew up in a very poor family. First in my family to go to high school, first in my family to go to college. And my wife and I, she was one of the first in her family to go to college. And we talk about this, that it's harder today than it was 20 years ago. When we went to college. It is harder today. I don't know why, I don't understand it, but it is harder today, ladies and gentlemen. And this graph confirms it for me. This is why this work is so personal for us. That's why we want to show, because over 90% of our children live in poverty. So when you look at that bottom line, and by the way, we only represent 1% of the state. We represent 1% of the state. We have 53,000 children. The state has 5.5 million children. So I want you to just appreciate the context of that. By the way, not because we want to make an excuse, but we need to understand it. Because if we don't understand it, we will make the same mistakes over and over again. So that's why when you see us doing the things we're doing, know that at a minimum, we are challenging ourselves and saying, let's not do the same things over and over again because we see the results. And by the way, this is not about Pedro Martinez. This is not about Patty Rado. This is a community effort. It's not about one individual, but we have to solve this. We have to solve this problem because we know, again, what the history shows us. So let's talk about year one. So I'm finishing a year and a half. Again, feel so blessed to be with you. And I will tell you, year one for me was, I wanted to understand it. So I've done this work long enough where I made a lot of mistakes in my career. And I, you know, we did, when I was in Chicago working with Arnie Duncan, we tried everything. I mean, ladies and gentlemen, we tried any program you can imagine, we tried it. We had 400,000 kids, 700 schools. We could do a lot of experimentation. I mean, we tried everything. And at the end, we never found that magic bullet. What we found was strong principals, strong teachers, caring for our children, high expectations. That was it. It didn't matter if it was a charter school, didn't matter if it was a traditional school, didn't matter if it was a magnet program. That's what we found. That was what we found in our work. So know that as we do this work, that's what grounds us. So we unveiled our blueprint for success. We started talking about our strategies. We grounded ourselves with five pillars: academic excellence, talent management, culture shift, stakeholder engagement, and fiscal management. Everything we do is grounded in these pillars. Every single initiative we have goes back to these pillars. So
So that is what helps us to organize our work. It helps us as we structure everything. And one of the things that I've learned in my career, this is about building systems, and this is a marathon. This isn't something that will change overnight. I just showed you those graphs, because trust me, there's a lot of smart people that have been in our district before. And again, it's about systems, and it's about thinking longer term, and again, looking at ways to solve these challenges. So academic excellence. In our first year, we opened up a very innovative school called the Young Men Leadership Academy. I'm gonna show you a little video about it in a second. Amazing school. In its first year, 4th through 6th grade was the top 3 in our district in its first year. By the way, these were boys that, and I don't know if you guys have children, if you have boys, I have a 6-year-old boy. I'll tell you, having children later in life, I would not advise it. He keeps us young, but I'll tell you, he is all boy. I mean, he is just an amazing amount of energy. But one of the things that was great about the Young Men Leadership Academy, so the research said, and it was really interesting, so I asked our principal, I said, Derek, tell me why you started in 4th grade, because I find that fascinating. And he said, because the research was really clear that as soon as kids are tested in 3rd grade, all of a sudden, we look at our children differently, because we see the scores. And especially with boys. And it's one of the things we always have to think about. Even as parents, there's research that says that as soon as you start seeing grades and test scores, your view of your children actually changes. I mean, think about that for a second. So our boys, especially boys of color, already, because they're active. I mean, they're mobile. And again, our view changes about them. So we wanted to create a school that was different for them. And I'll tell you, so you'll see a video in a second of that school. What we also did, and lessons learned, we opened up a brand new school in 6 months with almost 600 students. Thank God that we survived that. We hired an amazing principal, Kathy Beezer, who's here right now in our audience. Just an amazing school, and it's in its first year, and I will tell you, see a little bit of video of that, very different type of school. Very different than what our community has seen. The support we're getting for it is amazing. I will tell you, we already have a waiting list that's several hundred students for this school, and it's barely in its first year. But the parents can see it. I mean, you can see it, and again, you're gonna see a little video about that. We also started developing our strategies around academics. We brought in Dr. Doug Fisher, who's the national expert on instruction. And he actually trains our principals and is working with us to train our teachers, and brought him in. You know what was interesting also? So in our first year, we also set out a very clear direction. So as part of our blueprint, we laid out 10 aggressive goals. And one of the things we said is, even though the work was early, we wanted to see the capability of our staff. And with you, it was amazing. This is just 2 examples. We had over 30 schools that, even with harder assessments, had distinctions. But these 2 are 2 examples of schools that stood out. We had Davis Middle School with Julio Garcia, one of our amazing middle school principals. Lowest performing middle school in our district, just before I got here, we put him there in 1 year, ladies and gentlemen. He literally more than doubled some of our test scores and went from being the lowest performing middle school in our district to having a distinction in science in 1 year in middle school. Gates Elementary School is another one that actually in some of their test scores almost tripled in some cases. And again, went from a low performing school to having 5 out of 6 distinctions in the state. So again, examples of what is possible in our district. And one of the things we also did is, we went to some of our higher performing schools. And everybody, by the way, when I came to the community said, Pedro, you have schools like Young Women Leadership Academy, you have Travis. And we talked to them and said, guys, we need you guys to really show us what you can do. So Travis has been named as a nominee for the National Blue Ribbon. By the way, 100% of their class got associate's degrees last year, and this is a great story. 86% got it during their 4 years while they were in high school. President Vela from San Antonio College said, you know what, that other 14%, I'm gonna bring them in for the summer, because all they need is a few credits, and I'm gonna get them their associate's degree. And we had 100% of our students last year for the first time ever having the best program for an associate's degree. When you see President Bell, please share with him our appreciation, because he's there at our graduations. He is there at every event that we have with the kids. I mean, he is a true partner in this.
And of course, Young and Abdelia, our amazing principal here, also amazing school, 100% graduation. And we challenged Abdelia, we said, look, when we look at Young and Militia Academy, we gotta show what's possible. 100% of these girls are going to four-year universities, top universities across the country, ladies and gentlemen. It was work, just like Adelia's, that allowed us in our district, we went from 3% of our graduates to 5% attending tier one universities, including some of the colleges that you see here on the screen. So, I mean, Adelia led the way with 100% of her girls doing that. And of course, she also was the National Blue Ribbon School for 2015. So now let's talk about year two. So year two, now for us became, so first year was about, we wanted to learn, we wanted to set a clear direction, we wanted to raise expectations. Year two became really about now starting to implement our strategies and starting to set the conditions for change. And one of the things that we learned very quickly is that we didn't have enough resources. You know, it was fascinating, when I came to the district, I was in a meeting with about 30 of my colleagues, superintendents across the country, and I saw these big stacks of paper that were all about, you know, the plans for the settlement once we won the lawsuit for education funding. So it was like this thing, and by the way, the price tag was over $3 billion, and there was about four different ones. And it was Northside, and Houston, and Dallas, and I'm just watching this, because I'm fascinated by it. I'm just seeing these stacks of paper. And everybody's just, you know, said, well, we're going to go with option one because it helps, you know, Houston more. And I'm like, oh, no, we're going to go with option two because it helps Northside more. And there was this huge debate. And I just thought, my goodness, $3 billion. And then, of course, you know the end of the story. We found out from, and everybody was kidding, like, when are we going to find out? Another week. And then we found out what happened, right? We lost the lawsuit. And we saw at that time in our district, we said, my goodness, if we don't have resources from the state, what are we going to do? We had a deep discussion with our trustees and said, how do we make sure that we can really continue this path without sufficient resources? And as President Rito said, the community stepped up. Out of 160 voting precincts, 159 voted for both ballot questions, many of them by more than 70%. I think that's unprecedented, folks. I think that is unprecedented. At the same time, we got aggressive about applying for grants. So we got the largest federal grant ever, $46 million over 5 years. And I'm going to talk more about how we're going to use these resources. And so we said, again, we're setting up the conditions for change. So now let's talk about our pillar of talent management. At the end of the day, as I shared before, there is no magic bullets. It's all about the quality of our folks, how we support them, the expectations we have for our children. So here's what I want you to know what we're pushing right now. And you know, I share this with our staff. You know, so the ballot questions, you know, that we were, you know, advocating for that across our community last year. Now this has become our new mantra, which is we want to identify internally and recruit externally so that we will have over 1,000 of our teachers that are master teachers. By the way, does not mean necessarily advanced degrees. These are teachers who are mastering their craft, who have shown a track record of student achievement. And what we want is to recognize these teachers. We want to recognize them, we want to elevate them. These are teachers, by the way, you know, as I'm going to our schools and I'm finding them, it's amazing because I love this. So I walked into one school. This school had 6 out of 6 distinctions, one of our top performing schools, very quiet school, by the way. Nobody ever, you know, looks at this school. And I tell the principal, I said, you know, show me some of your master teachers, you know, that I want to recruit for this initiative. So I met this teacher who was 70 years old. By the way, does not look 70. 70 years old. Very passionate, you know, just a very different type of teacher. And the principal said, look, I gotta warn you. I mean, her classroom doesn't look like the traditional way. It's just, she's really different. But by the way, 100% of her kids are passing and exceeding the state standards. And I found out, and I asked her a little bit about, you know, what she does. And one of the things that I learned about her was that during lunchtime, she's a fourth grade teacher. She brings up her children and eats lunch with them every single day. Drives the principal crazy, by the way. But has such a connection with those kids, with those students, like one that I've never seen before. And then the same school, I found another teacher who was in her third year getting the same results. And then I met another teacher who was a preschool teacher, 20-year veteran, who said, Superintendent, I just, you know, I keep trying to leave preschool. I keep trying to leave preschool, but I just, you know, it's like a magnet for me. I can't leave preschool. And I said, you shouldn't leave preschool. Preschool is one of the best investments in art that we can make. And so these are examples of master teachers. So our goal is to have at least 1,000 of our 3,000 teachers to be master teachers over the next 5 years. We will pay them an extra $15,000. By the way, we're asking them to work an extra month, and we're asking them to work an extra 5 hours a week. Because we want to leverage those teachers to be part of our leadership team, to help us solve the problems, and then we want another third of our teachers to be in a pipeline to become master teachers. That is our vision. We hire about 500 teachers every single year, ladies and gentlemen. So I'm always gonna have a team of teachers that are newer teachers, inexperienced, that are in their first 3 years. There's always gonna be about 1,000 there, but that's the goal. That's the vision we have. I will tell you, we just started this campaign, so please spread the word. We're getting a lot of interest. We already have more than 200 applications, internal and external, and we're just starting. But that's what we want. By the way, and just in case if you're thinking about a Q&A, where teachers top out in salary in our county, by the way, this also is the same in Travis County, teachers here, once they hit over 20 years, they top out at about $65,000 a year. They top out at $65,000 a year. In this initiative, our teachers will make well over $80,000 a year. That's what we're trying to do. So the other thing we did is, and this is on your table, we also started putting some very interesting tools, both for parents and teachers. And what you have on your table is what we call the NWA MAPS report. And what's great about it is that it shows information where our children are at in the district. It shows them where they're at nationwide. And it actually shows an expected amount of academic growth for every one of our children. So step back for a second and think about how powerful this tool is for our teachers, because they know this assessment is given at the beginning of the year, in the middle of the year, at the end of the year. They know where children are coming in. They know, by the way, in the detailed analysis, they know by state standard. They know how it gives them tools to how to group children together. Because one of the things we learn is that even with high poverty children, many of them come in already with a lot of talents. And sometimes our traditional tools don't identify that. And so to give teachers that information right from the very beginning, and I'll tell you, our best teachers will say, this confirms what I've seen, takes me about my first month to see. I can see it almost immediately once I see these results. The tool for parents, where parents can know exactly where their children are at, not only, again, within our district, but nationwide. This assessment is given to millions of children every single year, and they can see where they're at. We also said, again, this is about part of our work doing things differently, because the challenges that we have in our state is that almost 55% of our teachers are alternatively certified. What does that mean? Is that there's a shortage of teachers. So we have the colleges of education, they only produce about 45% of the teachers statewide. That means the majority of our teachers, they usually get degrees that are not in education, nothing wrong with that. There's several programs to get alternative certifications. I mean, you pay several thousands of dollars. Most of those teachers have never spent any time in our classrooms. By the way, some of them are great, but again, it's just such a difficult model, and this is a statewide issue. So we said, you know what, we gotta do things differently. So we started creating our own lab schools, where we have, just like the medical profession, we have residents for a year, and then over that year, they take over the classroom. By year one, they have a teaching certificate. By year two, they will have a master's degree. Very different model. We started this with ALA. Ogden Elementary School will start as a lab school with 25 residents this fall coming up. And then CAS is also, we're also planning a lab school with UTSA starting next fall. Oops. In addition to that, we have existing what's interesting in our state is we have very few specializations around literacy. And one of the biggest challenges we see with our children, especially pre-K to 3, is around literacy. We went to Texas A&M with Dr. Mattson and said, create something that's customized for what we need, where you have not only a master's degree, but a master's degree and to become a literacy specialist. And we created that. And by the way, we had 20 slots. We had over 80 teachers apply. And the 20 teachers that are going through the program now have shared with us that it's completely changed the way they're doing their work, in not only in their classroom, but also how they're influencing their colleagues. So I'm going to talk a little bit about innovation, and you know, you're going to see a video in a second about for two of our amazing schools. And one of the things that I'll just say about innovation is that when you look at how we're doing things, I mean, you may call it innovation, and I love that compliment. I will tell you again, we're doing things differently, we're problem solving, and we're giving options to families. So let us just hear this video. So John, if you can help us with this video.
To learn interactively. When I ask questions, it helps me understand it more. We do a lot of research.
I didn't want my daughter to be going to a school where all they would really do is open the book, read the chapter, answer the questions.
They wouldn't have learned as much if I had shown them pictures of all these works of art. They had to go out and feel the weather and talk to each other and come back and research.
So I'm very curious. Once I learn something, I'm like, wait, I have a question. I have another question.
I don't like just learning from a teacher. I like going online and looking for good information.
The Advanced Learning Academy is a collaborative place for students, but it's also a highly collaborative place for the teachers and all adults in the school who work together on a daily basis to plan interdisciplinary project-based curriculum to really make learning relevant and rigorous for students.
Opportunity is one of my main reasons to be here. Yes, the projects are very fun. They help us learn these things.
Once you see that there's something that is kind of the angle where they're interested, if they like sports, if they like movies, whatever that happens to be, and you can find a way to drive the instruction in those directions, that tends to be the best way to really kind of ignite that passion for their learning.
We were talking about never give up, so then the teacher wanted me to tell my story about how I didn't give up and kept going and how I got the highest grade in the class.
Guide Talk is a motivational, inspirational time of day that we carve out for all of our student body, teachers. We all come together as a family and we just talk about things.
Each time you come, you learn something new, you learn something creative, and you apply that to everyday life. They're here for you.
The community to really hold us accountable, as you look at these new models that are coming out, not only are we seeing, again, a lot of promise in the results, but what I love is that when you go visit these schools, again, it's just such a different culture. It's just such a different set of expectations. At ALA, for example, the schools doesn't have traditional bell times. They have bands of grades where children can, if you're a kindergartner, you'll have interaction with first, second, and third grade. The teachers are planning together. If you're in our middle school grades, again, they're in band of grades or in high school. Very different type of work, very project-based. At the Young Men Leadership Academy, Derek will tell you that our boys get 5 high fives every single day. Whether it's the custodial person, the counselor, the level of confidence that these boys have. And keep in mind what I told you earlier about our theory when we opened up that school. When our boys, when those test scores come out after third grade, people look at them differently. They just do. And like I said, there's a lot of research that we as parents, we start looking at our children differently when we see those test scores and we see those grades. And there's a lot of research about that. So they're, again, a different approach. And like I said, already one of the top three schools in our district in its first year. Next year, we are opening up 5 new models. 5 new models. The first Montessori school, first public Montessori school in our district, in the South Side. Steel Montessori. We had an information night. And I'll tell you, I got there early, I didn't see any parents, and I thought, oh my God, it's gonna be an empty room, media's gonna be here, it's gonna be an empty room. 5 minutes before we started, we had standing room only, and at least 100 parents that had called us that could not make it, but said, we're interested in this model. In just that first information night. We have Cast Tech, which if we had more time, and you can Google it, you can see the video of what that school's gonna look like. I mean, state of the art. I mean, just, you have to look at it. Just Google it and you will see Kate Rogers is here, our amazing partner from HEB. Just a very different type of school. We have Ogden who's opening up, and we have Michelle here, our amazing principal, who will have a lab school with 25 residents working with a very innovative group coming out of New York called the Relay Group. Again, very, very innovative model. Lamar Elementary School, completely different calendar. We have Brian Sparks, our amazing principal. By the way, he has his wife, who teaches at LA, is probably one of the best teachers in the district. So we get sort of a two-for-one deal with Brian and his wife. Amazing. 11, by the way, they calendar will be an 11-month school year. LMR will start a dual language academy next year. Very, very innovative things going on. By the way, we have now a waiting list at Lamar Elementary School. So this area, is again, it's just become so popular. And then Twain Dual Language Academy. Our goal at Twain is that not only will our children be fluent in a second language, they will be biliterate by eighth grade. They will be taking advanced placement classes in Spanish by eighth grade. That is what we're building at Twain, and that's opening up this fall. Five brand new models. So, you know, as Ms. Rado said, we're going at about 90 to 100 miles an hour. We're trying to show the community what is possible with very different models, because we know that if we show these proof points, first of all, our parents respond, and we're seeing it in the interest, and we want to show what is possible even when you have children that live in poverty, even when you have children that are struggling. And of course, you know, we're also looking at things at scale. One of the things that we learned early on was that many of our children were struggling when they went from elementary to middle school. Here's what also was interesting. When I looked at our enrollment and I saw enrollment declines, our biggest enrollment declines were in those middle school grades. So our parents were also speaking to us, except, you know, parents, you know, they don't necessarily complain. They just walk away. They literally just go to a different school. So this year we started converting 11 of our schools, elementaries and low performing middle schools. So high performing elementary schools, we're expanding them to eighth grade. Low performing middle schools, we're redesigning them to become pre-K-8 models. By the way, Twain was, you know, a struggling middle school. And now we'll be one of our most innovative dual language academies starting next fall with pre-K-2. So we are making changes, and these are big structural changes. But again, we're, as our trustees would always say, we are focused on students. We are focused on what works for them. We will have, ladies and gentlemen, the largest international baccalaureate program in the entire county in the next 2 years. The largest. And if you want to see what it looks like, go to Woodlawn Academy, who's up for authorization this year. I can see the difference in the instruction. I can see the difference in the classroom. There was a project that they were doing just the other week where they were looking at the breakup of the USSR. So just think about the context of what's going on right now with Russia, right? They were studying the breakup of the USSR, and the students were struggling with all the different countries and the names, but they were studying about the demographics and the lifespans and the education levels and about that whole context of what happened in the USSR. I mean, that's what they're learning. That's what they're working on. That's what you're gonna see through the International Baccalaureate Program. Just again, we're already seeing the impact in our classrooms. And this is what's exciting for me. I'm very personal. So I showed you those earlier slides, and I showed you the context of what we're working on. I will tell you that where we are sticklers, where we're gonna be stubborn, is we're gonna change the conversation. We're gonna change the conversation about what our children can do. We're gonna change the conversation about what our belief systems are about our children, because we have to challenge ourselves. We have to challenge ourselves here in this room, in this community. We're challenging ourselves with our staff. That is the work. That is the work. And so, you know, I get challenged on this, and I say, Pedro, why do you push college so much? Why do you do that? Why do you push 2-1 universities? Because what I have found in my 20 years of doing this, when you have children that can elevate at the highest level, it sets the tone for everybody else. If our top performing children cannot reach top universities, it sets the tone for everybody else. Because remember your years in high school. Remember how cliquish it was. Remember how everything was so, you know, magnified 1,000%, right? Whatever happened in your life, friendships and relationships, they look at everything. And when they see children that can do it, they say, okay, if that student, if she can go to Stanford, maybe I can try. But imagine if our top students are not getting to the top colleges, the message is sent to everybody else. So again, very early on, as I shared with you last year, we were able to increase the number of students that got into top tier one universities from 3 to 5%. Look what's happening this year. So we doubled down on that. And right now we have more than 3/4 of our children are applying to college, and almost 9 out of 10 are applying to at least one four-year university. At least half of our students are applying to tier one universities across the country. By the way, we had a very, very, nice story last year from a community member. His name is Walter, who drove students every year to go see colleges. It was about less than half a dozen students. And that story then kind of blossomed into a much larger initiative. And look what we're doing this spring break. We're going to have over 80 students visiting universities across the country. These are our top performing juniors, by the way, so that when they go to their senior year, they'll have visited several campuses. And that's happening this spring break. So just to finish this up, so as we go into year three, here's what I want you to look for. We're going to push hard around culture shift and stakeholder engagement. In fact, at the end of this year, we'll be announcing a new compensation plan for principals that will be based on performance. And that'll be brand new because, again, we want to attract and retain the best principals. And so you will see that at the end of this year. You will also see a huge emphasis on stakeholder engagement. I mean, I am so proud to be here in this community that is so collaborative. But we are doubling down on more partnerships. We're going to partner with the chambers as we look at how do we partner industry with our high schools. This fall, we will be announcing a Principal for a Day initiative where I want community members to shadow our principals for half a day. I want you to see what it is to be a principal. And I want you to understand the work. So we're going to open up our buildings to the community. That will be coming this fall. We will be empowering parents in a way that has never been done before. You just saw a little bit of the tools that we're using with NWA Maps, which gives parents more information than ever before. So those are things that are coming up this fall. So with that, I think we have just a couple minutes for Q&A. Oh, and I want to recognize Richard Perez, our amazing member from the Greater Chamber. Thank you, Ramiro, for the amazing introduction.
Any questions? We have a couple of mics that are floating around, so if anybody has a question or two. I know that we're kind of just taken aback by all the fantastic things that are going on, but I know that we might have a question or two. There we go, right there.
Hi, good morning. Irene with MySR Center. Thank you for coming out to visit. I wanted to see what plans you had as you start opening the schools, particularly to the business community. What role entrepreneurship will be playing in SAISD?
It's a great question. So one of the things that you're going to see that's a statewide initiative is, first of all, if you look at our early college program, and Travis is a great example, very successful, we are now going to be doing what I call Early College 2.0, which is going to be that not only will children get certificates and associate's degree, but the goal is to tie them to specific industries and jobs that are in demand in the community. So that's something you're going to be learning more about. The other area that you're going to see us over the next 5 years, I would like to recruit 5,000 mentors for our juniors and seniors, because one of the things I'll tell you is we do this work for college. It is, again, there's a lot of support that these kids need. Many of these students are the first in their family to go to college. Many of our parents are working two jobs, and I'll tell you, to navigate the system today, it is harder than it was even 20 years ago. So look out for that as well, that I want schools to be adopted by industry partners. I want mentors in our buildings that we'll be pushing hard in the next 12 months.
You're on back there?
Hi, Brian Dillard from Dick and Wheel Neighborhood Association. Hi, Pedro. So it's been in the past where we've had a big Go Public campaign, and as somebody who works with charter schools and with public schools, or with SAIT very closely, and I've seen the good things that come out of KIPP, how's the partnership going to be in the future with regard to charter and SAISD?
It's a great question. So, what's fascinating about our state is that we have a concept called industry charters. And what's interesting is that all of our new schools are industry charters. So that gives them this, and we give, and the board has been amazing about this, we give complete autonomy to the school. That's where, again, we're doing things very differently. We're actually learning from some of our charter competitors. So the one thing I will tell you is it's a sort of friendly co-opetition, I would say. So we're going to continue to learn from each other. We're having, you know, some great partnerships with KIPP, for example, because they have a great initiative around how they follow kids after they actually get into college. And so we're actually copying that model from them. They're also copying a lot of practices from us, frankly. And so for us, you know, that's going to continue to be the work. I will tell you that we're going to advocate for high-quality schools. So whether it's our own schools or other schools in the community, that's going to be our focus because, again, you saw those graphs that I showed you earlier. This is a big problem statewide. This is a big problem nationally. And again, we need to make sure we have all the best ideas at the table.
We'll do one last one.
Hi, Fatima. Hi, I'm Fatima. I'm with SA Rise. And I have a question about the schools that you didn't mention up there. So the schools that aren't special in-district charters or academies, what is your plan for ensuring their success?
It's a great question. And so when you look at the master teachers, so one of the reasons that we went for the federal grant that we got, one of the reasons actually we went for the TRE and we talked about, especially around after school programs and summer programs, is to create this and recognize this cohort of amazing teachers. And I'll tell you, we'll have over 1,000 in the next 5 years, over 80% will be internal. I think that will be the game changer across all of our schools. And what I love, like I said, is, you know, as I'm meeting these potential teachers, they're all different, and I love that. I mean, they're all different, but that's what it takes, right? It takes these individuals who have this special magic. They're mastering their craft. They're showing success already with their children. And I'll tell you, and we're going to be very competitive. At Ogden, for example, we have to recruit 25 master teachers. So we're recruiting a lot aggressively externally. At ALA, all of our teachers are master teachers, and that's one of the reasons we're seeing success that we're seeing. So for us, you know, that's going to be our big initiative that will be district-wide, at scale. And then when we unveil our new compensation system for principals, our principals, ladies and gentlemen, will make more than 90% of my staff in central office. That's the way it should be, because they have a difficult job managing their many CEOs in their schools. That's what you're gonna see in this new compensation system that will be unveiled at the end of this year. So that will be scale, at scale, district-wide.
Well, let's hear a round of applause for Pedro Martinez and SAISD. Doing some very amazing things. And of course, all this stems from leadership, right? Things don't happen by themselves. They happen with people that are committed, that have vision. They have elected officials that are behind them, pushing them, giving them the resources necessary to do these things. So congratulations to the board as well. Let's give them a round of applause. So a couple of housekeeping things. We neglected to mention an elected official in the room. Her name is Sandy Wolf, and she's on the board at the Northeast Independent School District. Sandy, we're glad you're here. And an appointed official who serves on the Port of San Antonio Board, Chris Alderete. Chris, where are you? Please stand and be recognized. Thank you. So we're going to close with a couple of things. Well, number one is that immediately after this, around 9:30 or so, the Witte is actually having an event, a press conference, where they're going to be unveiling the name of the Witte. I think it's going to be a new name. So if anybody's interested in sticking around, if you just go out to the right and come to the kind of the front of the building, there'll be an event there if y'all are so inclined. If not, we thank you for joining us today. We ask you to continue to keep the faith. And the faith is important because without believing in something, it's hard to go after it, right? You have to have it in here. And you all are committed. You all do great things, but we need to do them together and take it to another level. And your Chamber of Commerce, my Chamber, Ramiro's Chamber, this community is ready to help. So thank you all very much, and we stand adjourned.